Ladies and gentlemen, co-workers in government, good afternoon. The Presidential Museum and Library, the Office of the President Cultural Affairs Committee, and the Presidential Communications Development and Strategic Planning Office are proud to present the first installment of the Presidential Lecture Series. This series is envisioned as a tool to inform the public about the life, achievements, and legacies of the persons who have occupied the highest political position of the nation. As part of the celebration of the 115th anniversary of the Office of the President, this particular lecture revolves around the contributions of the administration of General Emilio Aguinaldo, our first president, to the project of nation building. To enlighten us on this subject, we have invited the chair of the De La Salle University Department of History. He is also a commissioner of the National Historical Commission of the Philippines. He earned his bachelor's degree in philosophy from St. Camillus College Seminary and his master's degree in philosophy from the Ateneo. A contributor to various scholarly journals, he also authored the books The American Friar Lands Policy, Its Framers, Context, and Beneficiaries, and The Bearer of Pax Americana, The Philippine Career of William Howard Taft. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Rene Escalante.
Good afternoon to everyone. It's nice to be here in Malacañang. This is only my second time in this compound. Okay. My lecture will revolve around the presidency of Emilio Aguinaldo. But before I proceed with my slide presentations, let me just refresh your memory as far as Emilio Aguinaldo is concerned. Nowadays, there are at least a number of memories that we associate with Aguinaldo. If you still remember the old 5-peso bill, then we can see the face of Aguinaldo on it. And I think everybody knows that the general headquarters of the Department of the Armed Forces of the Philippines and the Office of the Department of National Defense is in Camp Aguinaldo. So it was also this camp is also named in memory of Emilio Aguinaldo. If you are a resident of Cavite, there is a highway there that everybody wants to avoid every rush hour because of terrible traffic. Well, every Christmas, hindi rin natin makalimutan yung pagbibigay ng Aguinaldo. I cannot see the connection. Probably some of you knows it. Anyway, this afternoon, we are going to discuss the presidency of Emilio Aguinaldo. I have to correct the tarpaulin because I did not add S in the contribution. It should be contributions because I will be mentioning at least 5 contributions. Another thing that I would like to remind everybody is when we evaluate the presidency of Emilio Aguinaldo, let us not use the contemporary parameters that we use in evaluating our recent presidents. So don't talk about GNP, don't talk about foreign reserve, employment rate, infrastructures, because I think these are contemporary parameters in evaluating the presidency of a particular person, because this is the period of Aguinaldo is roughly 110 years before our time. So those things, I think, it would not be fair on the part of Aguinaldo to use those measurements in evaluating his presidency. Now, I think I discussed this already. Okay. So my topic will be divided. My topic will be divided into at least 6 subtopics. So I will be starting with a short biographical remarks. on his life story. And then also I will discuss the source of the legitimacy of his presidency. Again, ano, once again, I would like to tell you that there was no COMELEC at that time. There was no presidential election at that time. So I think I have to discuss this a bit so that we can understand why we are calling him president. And then the heart of my talk will center on item number 3 and item number 4. And then towards the end, I will discuss some issues and controversies. A while ago, I asked Ryan kung merong kamag-anak dito si Aguinaldo because there might be some issues that I might bring up later on that might be offensive to the family of Aguinaldo. But rest assured that I will be very polite later on. And then, post-presidency, what happened to him after he stepped down into power? Remember that his presidency ended in 1901 and he died in 1964. So you can just imagine, almost 6 decades pa ang nakalipas bago siya tuluyang sumakabilang buhay. Okay. Let me start with some personal remarks on his family and personal background. So the parents of Aguinaldo were Carlos Aguinaldo and Trinidad Fami. His father died when he was only 9 years old. So it was really his mother who reared. They are 9 in the family. I think he was the 8th in the family. Okay. So he was born on March 23, 1869. So he is 8 years younger than Rizal. Rizal was born in 1861. In Cavite El Viejo, this is the old name for the present-day town of Cavite, where we can find the Aguinaldo Shrine. So every June 12, remember? This is where we celebrate the proclamation and the singing of the national anthem and the raising of the Philippine flag. And he died in February 6, 1964, at the age of 94. Pinakamatandang presidente na namatay. Okay. In fact, he outlived at least 5 presidents. Yeah, I'll discuss that later. Mawala yung suspense. Okay. He married twice. His first wife was Hilaria del Rosario. Fortunately, in 1921, she died of leprosy. And then 6 years after, he married Maria Agoncillo, the niece of Felipe Agoncillo. Felipe Agoncillo was the so-called foreign minister of the Malolos Republic. He represented the Philippines in the famous treaty of when US and Spain was negotiating the Treaty of Paris. Fortunately, he was not given due recognition. All in all, he has 5 children and some of them became prominent. We have Cesar Berata, a grand-nephew of Emilio Aguinaldo, and we have also the present-day congressman of Cavite, Emilio, what's his first name? Congressman Emilio Abaya, a grandson also of Emilio Aguinaldo, and Justice Melencio Herrera, one of the Supreme Court Associate Justices way back during the Ramos, I think, administration. And there are also a number of local government officials of Cavite who descended also from the clan of Emilio Aguinaldo. Because of lack of time, I will not anymore mention their names. Okay, let me say something now about his education. If we're going to compare him with the other presidents that we have, probably we can say that he is the least educated. He dropped out of school at the age of 13. He attended classes in San Juan de Letran. Unfortunately, he was able to finish his high school schooling. Okay. As a result of this, well, even compared with Bonifacio, Bonifacio is more of a learned man. At least in his biography, we mentioned that he read Rizal, and he read Victor Hugo's novel, and then the American presidents. But Aguinaldo, not so much. I quoted two remarks written by his biographers who said he could not understand the Spanish text. So imagine a person who was born during the Spanish period could not understand the Spanish text. It reflects the kind of education that he had at the time. And he personally confessed to never having read Rizal. So unusual for a prominent Filipino not to have read the novels of Rizal. But for sure, he was born in our time because of the Rizal law. He will be compelled to read the Noli Me Tangere and memorize the Mi Ultimo Adios. Okay? Tayo lahat duman dyan, di ba? Meron tayo lahat na Rizal course. Okay. So after he dropped out of his school, he helped his parents manage their farm and his mother's candy factory. So tinulungan niya na ang kanyang nanay na maghanap buhay. And later on, he became an inter-island trader. So he collected those merchandises that one could find in Cavite and then brought them to islands of Mindoro, Romblon, Marinduque, and some other islands in southern Tagalog and northern part of Mindanao. And for almost 5 years, this was his means of livelihood. Okay, as at a very young age, he was already engaged in politics. In fact, at the age of 17, he became the cabeza de barangay of one of the barrios in Kawit. And then in 1895, this is almost a year before the outbreak of the revolution, he was elected capitan municipal at the age of 25. Now, during this time, the Katipunan was already very active in the province of Cavite. Remember that at that time, before the outbreak of the revolution, there were two provincial councils in Cavite. We have the Magdiwang faction based in Noveleta, and we have the Magdalo faction in the southern part of, northern part of Cavite near Metro Manila. So Emilio Aguinaldo joined the Magdalo faction of the Katipunan. Later on, I will go back to this because this will create some troubles in Cavite and with the national leadership of the Katipunan itself. Now, when the revolution broke out in August of 1896, he took a very active role in the campaign against the Spaniards. So one of the battles where he personally fought was in the Battle of Zapote Bridge, wherein the Magdalo forces were able to repel the Spanish contingent headed by no less than General Camilo Pulavieja. And this is one event that really elevated the status of Aguinaldo as a military leader, which may be considered one of the reasons why he won the presidency in the Tejeros Convention that will happen 4 months after. Okay, so let us now proceed with the second part, source of the legitimacy of Aguinaldo's presidency. Remember that the Katipunan, before its discovery in August of 1896, used to be a secret society. Its aim was to overthrow the Spanish government. It was founded in 1892 after Jose Rizal was deported to Dapitan. Now, for almost 4 years, it operated as a secret society, recruiting so many members not only in Metro Manila but also in the nearby provinces. Now, after the outbreak of the revolution, the organization of the Katipunan became ineffective already. So they decided to come up with a new organization that would be responsive now to the need of that period. Remember that from August up to the end of 1896, The Katipuneros in Manila were not successful in their campaigns against the Spaniards. They lost in the Battle of San Juan and in other subsequent battles that happened within Metro Manila. Now, the reason why the Katipuneros in Manila lost was because at the outbreak of the revolution, the Spanish government recalled many of its troops who were used to be stationed in the provinces in order to augment the military contingent in Metro Manila. I think this is a normal and natural reaction for people who are in power to secure first their own home base before securing the other parts of the country. And this is what happened. So, rinicall ni General, Governor General Blanco yung kanyang mga tropa sa labas ng Manila para palakasin ito. And sa consequence of this, the Spanish forces in Manila became very strong and they were able to repel the forces of Bonifacio in Manila. And as a consequence of this, towards the end of 1896, Bonifacio went to Cavite. As I told you a while ago, there were two factions in Cavite at that time and they were operating separately. Now, there were proposals coming from many sectors of the Katipunan, from the ranks of the Katipunan, to unite the two factions because they heard some news that the next target now of the Spanish forces, once they've neutralized already the Katipuneros in Manila, was to neutralize also the forces in Cavite. So it created panic on the part of the Magdiwang and the Magdalo faction. So the leadership of the two factions decided to convene a convention with the objective to unite the two forces. And it happened on March 23 is the birthday of Aguinaldo. It happened in the Casa Hacienda de Tejeros. And many active Katipuneros were invited. And close to 300 delegates attended. Now, the participants in this convention agreed that there is a need to reorganize the Katipunan. So the original hierarchy of the Katipunan that was operating before the discovery was changed significantly, particularly down the wire, yung mga functions sa baba. And they also agreed to elect the leaders of the newly formed unified Katipunan forces. And in this marker, we can see the winners of the election. Okay, so Emilio Aguinaldo was elected president. As a footnote here, Aguinaldo was elected in absentia. In other words, he was not there. He was very busy defending Pasong Santol when the convention was going on. But he was nominated and he won. Mariano Trias was elected vice president. Artemio Ricarte was elected captain general. Emiliano Riego de Dios was elected director of war. And lastly, Andres Bonifacio was elected director del interior. Okay? Now, the presiding officer of this convention was Andres Bonifacio. And he was presiding this meeting or this convention as the supremo of the Katipunan. He practically ran, it was all in these positions that I enumerated, and he lost. The statistics for the president is this. No? So there were three candidates for president. Emilio Aguinaldo, Andres Bonifacio, and we have the last, Mariano Trias. And below we have the scores. Partida pa yan, hindi pa siya nandun, hindi pa nakampanya. He won by a big margin, 146 over 80. And Mariano Trias got the lowest vote, but when the election for vice president was held, ang nanalo ngayon ay si Mariano Trias. Now, going back to the election for the director del Interior, Bonifacio was elected. But after he was proclaimed winner for this particular position, Daniel Terona questioned the competence of Bonifacio. According to Daniel Terona, the position of Director of Interior is a very delicate position, and he suggested that it should be occupied by a lawyer. Well, in the beginning, before the election was conducted, the Supremo, I'm referring to Bonifacio, told the participants that whoever will be elected should be respected regardless of his credentials. So Bonifacio felt so offended when Daniel Terona questioned his credentials. And I have a picture, and this is a dramatization of what happened when Bonifacio shouted at Terona to rebuke him for his comments. So, according to the accounts of Santiago Alvarez, bumunot na pistola dito si Bonifacio at gusto niyang barilin si Daniel Terona. Okay? But unfortunately, there were several delegates who, prevented this untoward incident from happening. So all of a sudden, the two parties will calm down, and the result of the election was not very encouraging because Bonifacio, using his position as Supremo of the Katipunan, declared the election null and void. This is now the start of the tension between the Magdiwang and the Magdalo factions of the Katipunan. Remember that the Tejeros Convention was primarily convened to unify the two factions. But the end result of the convention was it further divided the two factions that will lead ultimately to the execution of the Bonifacio brothers. Okay. So what happened after the Tejeros Convention? Well, typical Filipino politics. So, sa Pilipinas daw walang natatalo lahat dinaya, no? So, yung mga natalo, nagkumpul-kumpul. Yung mga nanalo, nagdiwang. Okay. So, Bonifacio tried to schedule another meeting and another election. But the camp of the Magdalo didn't want it to happen anymore. The Magdalo camp considered the proceedings of the Tejeros Convention valid, and therefore, they have now a leader. They have now a president. The Magdiwang side were divided. Some of them recognized the result of the Tejeros Convention. Others, who were loyalists of Bonifacio, said it's null and void. Okay. Probably at this point, we can ask some questions. Why is it that Bonifacio lost, despite the fact that he was recognized as one of the founding founders of the Katipunan, and he was the incumbent supremo of the Katipunan at that time? Well, Teodoro Agoncillo, in his book, The Revolt of the Masses, gave at least three reasons, okay, why Bonifacio lost and why Aguinaldo won. Well, a while ago I mentioned that in terms of military credentials, the performance of Bonifacio was very poor compared with the achievements of Emilio Aguinaldo. In short, the Katipuneros in Manila, headed by Bonifacio, lost several battles, while the Katipuneros in Cavite, headed by Aguinaldo, they were winning practically all the battles before the Tejeros Convention. Obviously, it made Aguinaldo very popular. And the other side of the story is it made Bonifacio unpopular, and he was perceived to be a weak military leader. Okay, that's number one. Number two, the election was held in Cavite. Okay? You know what I mean? Many of these delegates were either from Cavite or Batangas. The delegates from Manila could not attend because there were already Spanish soldiers guarding the exit point going to Cavite. Sa basketball, merong home court advantage. Okay? Merong home court advantage, Aguinaldo. Third, I mentioned a while ago that there were three candidates. The Magdalo fielded only one. The Magdiwa, Mariano Trias is identified with the Magdiwa camp. So, in a divided election, we can always expect that the party that fielded only one will have a bigger chance of winning the election. But even if it's a one-on-one battle between Aguinaldo and Bonifacio, we'll go back to the statistics. Kung pagsasamahin natin yung 80 and 30, that's only 110. Kapos pa rin. Kapos pa rin. So, it might be a reason, but the effect as far as the outcome of the election might not be material on this part. So, I would suppose that the home court advantage was the ultimate reason why Bonifacio lost the election and Aguinaldo won. Until now naman tayo mga Pinoy, di ba? Pagkababayan, kababayan yan, di ba? Anong performance niyan? Kasi kababayan eh. Oh. Typical characteristic of Philippine politics, where we now. Okay. Try to avoid this part. Ano? So we know that after the Tejeros Convention, the rift between Aguinaldo and Bonifacio went from bad to worse. And Bonifacio was already on his way out of Cavite. And when he was already in Silang, he asked for provisions from the local residents there. And then the Silangenos did not give him what he was asking. So sa galit ni Bonifacio, parang nakapagsalita siya na buti pa sa bayan na yan ay sunugin, walang malasakit sa mga revolusyonaryo. Nakarating ito sa Magdiwang camp. And that remark was seriously considered by the Magdalo camp. So, all the while they thought that Bonifacio was about to attack the town of Silang for refusing to give him what he was asking for. So, nagpadala ngayon na tropa ang Magdalo. At dito, inaresto si Bonifacio. Nagkaroon ng putukan, namatay ang isa sa mga kapatid ni Bonifacio, si Riaco. Bonifacio died while the arrest order was implemented, and the Bonifacio brothers, I'm referring to Andres and Procopio, were both wounded. And later on, they were tried. Initi sila sa Marabundon, the charge of treason for the refusal to recognize the result of the Tejeros Convention. So, they were found guilty, and the punishment was capital punishment. If you're going to read the works of Emilio Aguinaldo, his mga gunita ng Himagsikan, sinulat niya doon na he commuted the death sentence. But for whatever reason, it was carried out. So, pinatay yung mga kapatid na Andres Bonifacio and Procopio Bonifacio. Well, this is a very sad part of our Philippine history. Well, in the case of Rizal, we celebrate his day on December 30, 1896. This is the day he was executed. In the case of Bonifacio, it's November 30. This is the date he was born. He died in May 10, 1897. You can see the inconsistency of Philippine history. Why? Because in the case of Rizal, he was executed by our mortal enemies, the Spaniards. So he was considered a hero. But in the case of Bonifacio, in the case of Bonifacio, we cannot highlight his death anniversary because it is a dark side of our history. Because he was killed by the members of the very organization that he founded. Later on, the same event will happen to Antonio Luna, but we'll come to that later on. Now, what happened after the death of Andres Bonifacio? Let's say 1/3 of the original members of the Katipunan felt sad and they abandoned the revolution because for them they felt betrayed of what happened to their supremo. And during this time, the reinforcements coming from Spain arrived already. And also during this time, Manila was already controlled by the Spaniards. So they now, the Spaniards now, and by this time, Ramon Blanco was already replaced by a military general who is more determined to crush the rebellion than him. So tinutukan na nila ngayon ang Cavite. And after this, Emilio Aguinaldo will experience series of military defeats. So he has no choice but to leave his own homeland. And he went to present-day Rizal until he reached San Miguel de Mayumo, where you can find that place, Biak na Bato. Yeah, augmented by new recruits from Spain, Spanish troops captured several towns in Cavite. As argued by Apolinario Mabin and others, the succession of defeats for the rebels could be attributed to the discontent that resulted from Bonifacio's death. Okay? So, meron na bang nakarating dito sa Biak na Bato? Where is San Miguel? If you're going to Nueva Ecija, you take the Plaridel or the Pulilan exit, you have to pass by Pulilan, what's this, Baliwag, San Rafael, San Ildefonso, and then we have San Miguel, the town of San Miguel. I understand San Miguel is the last town of Bulacan. After that, we have now the province of Nueva Ecija. This is still a very remote place, even at our time. So, a very safe place to hide from military operations. Now, in Biak na Bato, the forces of Aguinaldo asked their colleague, Isabel Ortacho, to draft a constitution. So this is one of the achievements of Aguinaldo while staying in Biak na Bato. So we have the Biak na Bato Constitution. Okay. Now, it was also in this very same place where the Spaniards and the forces of Aguinaldo were able to come up with a ceasefire agreement. Now, by this time, we have to digress a little bit. No? Remember that in 1896, Spain was fighting two wars in two different battlefields. the Cubans were also at war with the Spaniards, and the Spaniards were also at war with the Filipinos in our country. They wanted to concentrate first with the war in Cuba. That's why they were looking for some diplomatic means in order to settle the disputes in our country. And good that Pedro Paterno volunteered to serve as peace broker. So for several weeks, Pedro Paterno frequented Biak na Bato, asking Aguinaldo to articulate what are his demands. And finally, before the end of 1897, they were able to agree on some terms of surrender. Okay? So, the first agreement was the Spanish government will grant amnesty to those Filipinos who participate in the 1896 uprising. So all crimes committed during this period in pursuit of this goal will be pardoned by the Spanish authorities. Number two, the camp of Aguinaldo also agreed that they will leave the Philippines, go to Hong Kong. Of course, the most, I would say, convincing part of the peace agreement would be the monetary settlement. The Spanish government promised to give the camp of Aguinaldo 800,000 Mexican dollar. And it will be given in three installments. The first half will be given outright before they leave for Hong Kong. The second 200,000 will be given the moment the remaining troops here will surrender their firearms. And the last, I think, it should be 200, I'm sorry. It should be 200. The last installment will be given once peace is completely declared. So what happened? The first installment was given. Ito yung baon ni Aguinaldo nung siya ay pumunta sa Hong Kong. The second installment was given. The last was overtaken by events because of the Spanish-American War. Hindi na ito nangyari. So in Philippine history, we call this the end of the first phase of the Philippine Revolution. There will be a lull from January to May of 1898. Why? Because Aguinaldo will be in Hong Kong. But there will be some events in America, particularly in Cuba, that will affect the developments in our country. And I am now referring to the outbreak of the Spanish-American War. I have some few slides here, but I will not deal with this matter because this is a concern that Americans and Cubans should discuss and not Filipinos. But we cannot avoid this because this will explain why Aguinaldo will return in May of 1898 and why there will be a second phase of the Philippine Revolution. And many of the contributions of Aguinaldo that I will highlight later on will be happening during the second phase of the Philippine Revolution. Okay, motives of colonization. I am now referring to the Americans here. Let's do some review of our U.S. history, the turn of the century. President of the U.S. during this time is President William McKinley. How are we going to describe America during this time? Remember that America had the Civil War in 1860s, and afterwards it was followed by Reconstruction, industrialization, and the emergence of America as a world power. So at the turn of the century, America now is competing. It's already considered an emerging power, world power, emerging world power. American factories were producing more goods that could be sold. They were actually producing too much. The U.S. had a large railroad network, which allowed manufacturers to quickly send their products to port for export, the large fleet of ships to deliver American goods anywhere in the world. What could be done with all the extra goods being produced? The American economy became one of the strongest in the world. American industrialists began searching for new markets around the world in which to sell their goods and new sources of raw materials to use in their factories. Having expanded to the West Coast, and with no more room for growth on the North American continent, any leaders longed to extend American reach beyond the existing borders of the United States. So at least America were encountering two major problems during this time. One, they were already experiencing, or they have already surplus products. And they were already running out of natural resources. Now, if they will continue to produce and there will be no extra market where they could sell their products, there's a big possibility that their economy might burst. And in relation to the second problem, if they will continue to utilize their own resources, sooner or later it will get exhausted and the country will suffer. Ito yung problema na kinarap nila at the turn of the century before the outbreak of the Spanish-American War. Okay? So in short, the desire for overseas empire was the primary motive why America took the Philippines. Now, America came late in the race to imperialism. French were already in Indochina. The British were already all throughout the world. Okay, the Portuguese were already in Macau. The Dutch were already in Indonesia, and so on and so forth. But there was one former superpower who were already dying during this period. I'm referring now to the Spanish monarch. The Spanish monarch could no longer handle the domestic problems in Cuba, in Puerto Rico, and in the Philippines. So, ang nasa isip dito ng mga Amerikano, we might as well inherit the former Spanish colonies. Kaya ang nangyari, after the sinking of the Maine in the port of Havana, they declared war with Spain, and at the time, Spain was no longer in the position to defend their territories, so natalo. And then from there on, they will now take over the former Spanish colonies. Let us continue with our slide presentation. So another motivation why they went overseas is that they were jealous, the European powers. Even in the case of Japan, expanding in Korea, in Manchuria, in some parts of southern Japan, which had conquered colonies and created overseas empires around the world. During this time, if you want to be considered a superpower, one of the credentials that you must have is that you must have a colony. Okay? So, because of their ambition to be labeled another superpower, then there was too much pressure on them to acquire also a colony. And Cuba, Philippines would be the best options. Now, they were also, as I mentioned a while ago, they were also looking for new markets. Tatlong famous American companies, I've shown in my slides. So we have Coca-Cola, of course, automobile industry, Ford, and sino ba naman ang ayaw ng McDo, di ba? So ang lahat ng ito ay naghahanap ng mga overseas markets. And they consider the Philippines a good option. Yeah, source of raw materials for American factories, particularly iron and coal. You really want to industrialize, these two minerals are badly needed. And we have good reserves of this. Well, the Navy was also looking for a staging point. Remember that during those times, they don't have yet the aircraft carriers. So if you travel that far, you need a place where you can recall or refuel. And they need a strategic refueling and recalling station in Asia so that their trips will not be affected. And they consider the Philippines strategically located in the region where they can put up their recalling and refueling stations. Yeah, this is just a continuation of that slide. Okay, here's another thing. Many American companies were also exploring the possibility of having a fair share in the lucrative China market. Remember that during this time, the population of China was very big already. And you can just imagine if they will buy American products. So until now, di ba? China is still a competitive market. So look at that, the illustration. So from the United States, they will use the Philippines as a staging point. But during this time, the Chinese melon was already partitioned, so to speak. So the Portuguese were already in Macau, the British were in Hong Kong, of course the Russians were in the north, and the Germans were in Shantung. So they could not penetrate. Even Secretary of State John Hay were campaigning for open door policy in China, but the Europeans said, okay, we'll not allow you to enter because you'll be one of our competitors here. China is already very crowded, and if you will still be accommodated, you will just create some animosity among us. So what the Americans plan to do is to use the Philippines as a staging point because they realized that there were so many Chinese merchants based in the Philippines and they can use this use them as conduits that could connect them in penetrating the Chinese market. So the 6 slides that I presented were the reasons why the United States got interested with our country. Remember that during this time, Aguinaldo was not in Manila. He was in Hong Kong. May demanda siyang kinasangkutan doon eh. But I will not deal into that, okay? Okay. So, on May 1 of 1898, the U.S. Asiatic Squadron, headed at that time by Commodore George Dewey, were instructed by Pentagon officials to leave Hong Kong. It used to be stationed in Hong Kong. They asked Dewey to go to Manila and destroy the Spanish Armada. The purpose was defensive. The war was really, the Americans were concentrated in Cuba, but they wanted to neutralize the Spaniards in Manila to prevent Manila Spaniards from sending reinforcements to Cuba. So they can only do that by destroying the naval assets of the Spaniards in Manila. So here we have the picture of George Dewey, and the other picture is the picture of Admiral Patricio Montojo, the commander of the Spanish Armada based in Manila. Now, it was a lopsided battle. The Spanish Armada was already very dilapidated. The morale of the soldiers were already very low compared with the U.S. Asiatic Squadron. The vessels were new. They enjoy a lot of provisions, and the morale of the soldiers were very high. So it was probably one of the most lopsided battles in naval history, and obviously the outcome was the Spanish Armada was completely destroyed. And afterwards, the U.S. Asiatic Squadron prevented sea vessels from entering Manila and from leaving Manila without passing the inspection of the forces of Dewey. Okay, it happened in May 1, 1898. So when Dewey defeated the forces of Patricio Montojo, there are now initiatives on the part of the consul of Singapore and Hong Kong to get in touch with Aguinaldo. I think that is the text. Yeah. They will now start connecting with Aguinaldo. So the U.S. government was represented by Spencer Pratt and by Ronsville Wildman. And finally, they were able to talk to Aguinaldo in Singapore in April.
And the substance of the negotiation or of the discussion was to convince Aguinaldo to go home and continue the fight against the Spaniards. During this time, the Americans, particularly the U.S. Asiatic Squadron, could not finish off the Spaniards because they don't have the necessary manpower. Remember that the U.S. Asiatic Squadron is a Navy contingent. So alam naman natin ang Navy is pandagat. Ano, yung mga Kastila noon ay nasa lupa. So they don't have yet an army during this time because the army was very busy in Cuba. So what they did is to encourage Emilio Aguinaldo to go home, provide him some ammunition and guns, and encourage him to continue the struggle against the Spaniards. So, itong supply ship na McCulloch, ito yung barko na sumundo kay Aguinaldo at ito rin yung nagdala ng mga armas. And Aguinaldo arrived in May 19, 1898. And right after his arrival, he reorganized once again the Katipuneros and renewed the struggle against the Spaniards. So May 19 onward, Aguinaldo once again experienced several military victories. That by the middle of June, the only area in Metro Manila that they could not fully control would be the walled city. Now, Aguinaldo was a little bit reluctant to attack Intramuros because he knows that the Spaniards there were well positioned and there is a big possibility that his men might be killed in that particular encounter. So what he did is to cut the supply of food and water, hoping that sooner or later, once they run out of food inside the walled city, the Spaniards will surrender. So ganun lang ginawa niya. Kinulong niya yung, ginardya niya yung Intramuros, at pinigilan niya yung mga traders na magpasok ng pagkain. Okay? So, for him, it's just a matter of time. Either they will die of starvation or those who don't want to die, they might surrender. Now, on June 12, and this is now a well-celebrated event in Philippine history, 10 years ago, oh no, way back in 1898, during the time of President Ramos, we celebrated the centennial of the independence of the Philippines. For those of you who are old-timers in Malacañang, alam natin na ito ay isang grandiosong celebration ng panahon ni FBR. Okay. So in June 1898, the island of Luzon, except for Manila and the port of Cavite, was under Philippine control or Filipino control. The revolutionaries were laying siege to Manila and cutting off its food and water supply with most of the archipelago under his control. Aguinaldo decided it was time to declare independence, which he did June 12, 1898. So it is a regular holiday. And this is an event that every year we celebrate. Okay? Now, aside from the Declaration of Independence, there are other events that happened during this time, which we ought to remember because these events will be associated closely with Emilio Aguinaldo. One, of course, is our Philippine flag. So, finally, the present flag that we use, this was officially hoisted as our national flag in this occasion. So I gave the names of those people responsible of making this flag. So we have Marcela Gonzillo and her daughters Lorenza and Delfina Herbosa. Now, before we started the celebration, we have the Philippine national anthem. So every time we sing or we play the national anthem of the Philippines, we should always remember Emilio Aguinaldo, because it was during his presidency when this national anthem was composed and first played. Okay? It's entitled Lupang Inirang. Music was composed by Julian Felipe, and the lyrics was from Jose Palma. So there are at least three legacies that we can get from this June 12 event. We have the Declaration of Independence, we have the national flag, and we have the national anthem. Now, in the beginning of this talk, I mentioned that let us not evaluate Aguinaldo based on contemporary parameters. Minsan yung mga presidente, pagtapos na sila sa kanilang termino, ang palagi nilang sasabihin, "Oy, ang tulay na yan ay ginawa nung termino ko." Diba? Yung munisipyong yan, ginawa nung termino ko. This is a familiar refrain of many politicians. So we talk about infrastructures. Kaya lang minsan ang tulay ay nasisira, ba? Dinadaanan ni Undoy, ni Sendong, ni Frank, di ba? Pag binabagyo. Yung mga municipal buildings, nasisira din, ano? So it may last 30, 40, at the most probably 50 years. Pero itong legacy ni Emilio Aguinaldo, sa tingin ko, ay imposible masira, imposible mawala. So, 1898, we are now 2012. We are still using the same flag, the flag that first used by Aguinaldo. We are still singing the same national anthem, the very same anthem that was played June 12 of 1898. And the text of that Declaration of Independence is still the very same text that we read every time we celebrate Independence Day, every June 12. So ito yung mga legacies ni Aguinaldo na sa tingin ko will outlive infrastructure projects, what else? Statistical records, what else? Economic performance, and the like. Okay? Now, another important contribution of Emilio Aguinaldo is the foundation of the Malolos Republic, which is considered the first democratic republic in Asia. If we will compare our country with other parts, with other countries in the region during this time, talking about 1898, all of them were still under colonial rule. The Dutch were ruling Indonesia, the French were ruling Indochina, the British were ruling Malaysia, Singapore, what else? Burma and India. But the Filipinos proclaimed already the first democratic republic in Asia. And we have already a constitution. The Malolos Constitution. Let's see that right upstairs. Okay? So on September 15, 1898, Aguinaldo called a Congress, a gathering of intellectuals during those times, and they're primarily tasked to write a constitution. The constitution that will serve as the fundamental law of the government that will rule our country. Now, during this time, Aguinaldo noticed already that the Americans will stay here for good. And his campaign now was to make the Americans irrelevant. Parang sinasabi niya, hindi namin kayo kailangan. We can run our own government. We can put up our own government. We have our own constitution now, so we don't need you anyway. So you can leave anytime. So Aguinaldo was very persistent on this. We have to do this, ASAP. Because if not, then we are just giving enough room for the Americans to come in and to justify their intervention. Kasi pwede na sabihin eh, hindi, kailangan man mag-stay kasi walang gobyerno, baka magkaroon ng anarchy. So Aguinaldo say, no. We can manage. Thanks. So to speak. And they were just buying time, waiting for the army contingent to arrive. And by the first quarter of 1899, they have already more than enough troops to control our country. And the next slides that I'll be presenting, something to do with the Filipino-American War. Anyway, I still have another caption. Malolos Constitution was ratified on November 29 and signed into law on December 31, approved January 20, and sanctioned by Emilio Aguinaldo and promulgated it January 23. It was first Republican Constitution in Asia. And in my, I put in close and open parenthesis there that one of the most controversial provisions of the Malolos Constitution was the separation of church and state. Okay? For four centuries, with the whole concept of patronato real, the functions of the church and the functions of the state were so intertwined that you cannot anymore distinguish what is civil and what is ecclesiastical. Okay? So it was so common at that time when the governor general is on leave, it's the Archbishop of Manila who is running the show. And sometimes vice versa. But in the Malolos Constitution, they categorically put it into writing that from then on, these two institutions will function separately. And every time this provision was under deliberation, according to the accounts of Felipe Calderon, the Barasoin Church was jam-packed. Kumbaga, blockbuster. Ang daming nag-a-attend because everybody wants to participate. And we know that when it was put into vote, halos hating-hati talaga yung election. Okay? Sabi ng iba noon, we need the support of the Filipino clergy in our fight against the Spanish friars. If we will isolate them, we might lose the support of the masses.